Today it's actually an NFAS based case presentation. So we will see about the basics of NFAS OCTA, the OCTA labs, and two cases and about the artifacts in OCTA. Over to Tejaswi.
Good evening, everyone. First, let me start with a small introduction on structural OCTA NFAS before going into the case discussions. So what is NFAS? NFAS means face to face. It is a French term. NFAS OCT is a frontal section of the retinal layers, also called as C-scan OCT. It incorporates all of the cross-sectional information of the conventional sagittal OCTs, and it also facilitates evaluation of the topographic location of the lesions, and the extent and expanse of the lesion can be better appreciated. As we know that the OCT angiography helps in visualizing microvasculature by detecting motion contrast from flowing blood, it also enables both the structural and angiographic analysis. OCTA machines take the volume cube and splits it into slabs by autosegmentation. This allows layer by layer analysis from the inner to the outer retinal layers. A structural NFAS OCT helps in evaluating each layer of the retina as a separate surface. The autosegmentation used in angiographic analysis also helps in structural NFAS imaging in the OCTA. So the autosegmentation for the inner retinal slab starts 3 microns below the internal limiting membrane to 15 microns below the internal inner plexiform layer. It incorporates the anatomic location of the superficial retinal vascular plexus. Generally, this is what we see on the traditional FA. Middle retinal slab, it starts 15 microns below the inner plexiform layer to the 70 microns below the inner plexiform layer. This incorporates the location of the deeper retinal capillary plexus. This is actually poorly seen on traditional FA. And this is considered as one of the most powerful capability of OCTA. Outer retinal slab starts 70 microns below the inner plexiform layer to 30 microns below the retinal pigment epithelium. It corresponds to a part of the retina within which there is never any vasculature in a normal individual. This should always be empty or blank unless there is a pathology. Choriocapillary slabs start 30 microns below the RPE reference to 60 microns below the RPE reference. It incorporates the choriocapillaries. ORCC slab is actually combines the both outer retinal and choriocapillary slabs used in some machines. So this is a here we can see a structural NFAS of the segmented layers of the macula at progressively deeper layers. This is the VRI slab at the vitreomacular interface. This it actually gives structural and dimensional details or patterns of the ERM macular holes, which can aid in the surgical planning of the membrane peeling. In the middle retinal slab, different patterns of PAM or paracentral acute middle maculopathy lesions can be better appreciated with structural OCT NFAS. In outer retinal slabs and ISOS junction slabs, the structural OCT NFAS helps in identifying margins of the geographic atrophy and also quantify the amount of disease progression. Now coming to our cases, the first case is a 52 years female presented with blurring of vision in left eye since 2 months. She's a known diabetic since 20 years. Her best corrected visual acuity in right eye is 6/6 and N6 and in left eye is 6/9 and N6. Anterior segment is within normal limits and intraocular pressure is 18 and 15 mm of Hg in right eye and left eye respectively. This is the color fundus image of both eyes. Right eye shows the media is clear, the disc is normal with healthy neuroretinal limb. A few arteriovenous crossing changes are seen with multiple hemorrhages and hard exudates, which are temporal, superior and some inferotemporal to the macula. A few of them are arranged in circinate pattern and few are scattered. There is a subretinal grayish appearance or retinal whitening, which is temporal to the fovea, if we can observe. coming to the left eye description, left eye also has AV crossing changes with multiple hemorrhages and few hard exudates, as less as compared to the right eye, and along with few cotton wool spots are also seen in the left eye. Temporal to the fovea, there is a retinal whitening with a pigment plaque. These are the red-free images of both eyes. The findings are seen more prominently along with the course of the vessels, and also the retinal whitening is clearly seen. This is the early phase of FFA showing microaneurysms, and the late phase showing the leakages through the aneurysms and also mild leakage seen temporal to the fovea. This is the early phase FFA of the left eye. We can see the NVE, temporal to the macula, and multiple microaneurysms. In the late phase, showing leaking of the microaneurysms with extensive capillary non-perfusion areas. Right eye also has multiple NVEs. This is the zoom in view of the macular features in both eyes. Now coming to the OCTA. Left side we have the angiographic images, and right side we have the structural OCTA images. Right eye, superficial capillary plexus. We can see perifoveal capillary network being disorganized with few dilated capillaries, and the deep capillary plexus slab shows dilatation and irregularities of the deep capillaries temporal to the fovea. In the structural scans, there is some abnormality in FZ, but hard exudates and microaneurysms are seen in the structural infarcts. No abnormal vasculature seen on the deeper layers of the retina. This is a horizontal B scan passing through the foveal center, shows a disruption of the ellipsoid zone temporal to the fovea. Few hard exudates are seen with back shadowing. It is the left eye superficial capillary plexus with distorted FAZ. The capillaries are actually dragged temporally with few dilated venules. The structural infarct shows cysts with irregular contour. The cysts are interconnected giving a petaloid appearance. There is an irregular hyperreflective lesion temporal to the fovea. The deep capillary slab shows irregularities in the deep capillaries temporal to the fovea, and the hyperplastic pigment plaque is seen here also. These are the outer retinal slabs, and here also we can see the shadowing of the pigment plaque, but there is no any abnormal vasculature. And the horizontal OCT scan, we can see the intraretinal cyst, and there is a ellipsoid zone loss and disorganization of the outer retinal layers. The clinical findings and the investigations are all suggestive of diagnosis being bilateral PDR with TFT or type 2 MACTEL. Here a study was done by Toto et al. On multimodal imaging on MACTEL type 2. They gave a grading on based on OCTA, where grade 1 is showing vascular abnormalities only temporal to the fovea. Grade 2 shows vascular abnormalities both temporal and nasal to the fovea. Grade 3 is circumferential vascular anomalies. And grade 4 is presence of neovascularization in the outer retina. Coming to the case 2, a 19-year-old male presented with the chief complaints of diminution of vision in both eyes since 2 years. Best corrected visual acuity was 636, 6x36 and N6 in both eyes. Anterior segment was unremarkable. Lens is clear in both eyes with IOP being 12 in both eyes. This is the color fundus image of both eyes. The media is clear and the distant vessels are normal. We can see the schisis at the macula with a spoke-like appearance in both eyes. The schistic changes are more prominent on red-free images. Here in the B scan, we can actually the ERG was done, and it showed the electronegative B wave. On this OCT, we can see small cysts in ganglion cell layer in both eyes and extensive cysts in the inner nuclear layer in the both eyes. These are the montage of superficial and the deep capillary plexus. These are the structural OCT infas of the middle retina, showing a hyporeflective cavity at the center of the fovea and radial hyporeflective cavities extending to the parafoveal region with hyperreflective partitions. This is often referred to as a radial spoke-like pattern. And the hyporeflective mesh-like cavities in the parafoveal region are referred to as a reticular pattern. The schisis also shows greater extension in the inferior extrafoveal quadrant in the right eye and superiorly in the left eye. The patient was diagnosed as X-linked retinoschisis depending upon the clinical and genetic assessment. These are the polygonal changes in the deeper retinal layers on the structural infas and the OCT. A few slides on the artifacts on OCTA. So why should we bother about artifacts in OCTA? An essential step in interpretation of any imaging modality is to ensure that the information or finding is real and it is not due to artifact. Artifacts can lead to abnormal structures that seem to occur in layers where they are not actually present, which leads to misdiagnosis. Therefore, particular attention should be paid to these artifacts when analyzing OCTA data to ensure correct clinical evaluation. Here we can see shadowing. Shadowing because of the vitreous opacity, vitreous floater. No flow is evident from the retinal vessel because of the loss of the signal. Shadowing can be caused due to hemorrhages, scar tissues, pigment clumps, which are blocking the light to reach the deeper layers. Here we can see the effect, how the projection artifact happens. The projection of the water coming from above, the flow which is flowing on the glass, which is transparent, it is projected onto the deeper layers. This is how the projection artifact happens. Because of this, the RPE will seem to have blood vessels which have pattern of overlying retinal blood vessels. And the superficial deeper retinal layers can be seen even in the deeper layers. This is the white line artifact or motion artifact associated with eye movement or microsaccades. Lateral displacement or part of the image leading to misalignment of the vessel on the octa image is seen. Eye tracking software reduces the motion artifacts. The vessel doubling we can see on these images. This is a defect related to the software correction of the eye movement. Here, two copies or duplication of the blood vessels are seen. Stretch artifact is also related to the software correction of the eye movement, in which a part of image seems to have been stretched, causing flattening of the vessels. Segmentation artifacts, because of the segmentation lines, the resultant image is really the vessels in more than one layer, shown as if they are existing in a single layer. It is more evident in the more common in the myopic eyes. So, advantages of structural infas OCT are: it provides improved visualization of the deeper layers of the retina and choroid when compared to FA and ICGA, and it generates high contrast images that are not obscured by the dye leakage, and it helps in dye-free imaging, and it does not expose the patients to risks associated with dye, and very helpful in patients where dye is contraindicated, and it is very fast and thus useful for patients that require recurrent vascular imaging. I want to conclude that ENFAS OCT is a user-friendly, non-invasive, reproducible technique that helps to understand better, diagnose and follow up the retinal and choroidal changes in type 2 macular telangiectasia. The combination of the structural and angiographic OCT with the cross-sectional scans help in earlier detection of the subretinal neovascularization. And the structural ENFAS OCT also helps in better delineation of the unique sciatic patterns in different layers of the retina. These are my acknowledgements. Thank you.
Thank you, Tejasvi, for the nice presentation.